Okay, so good morning, everybody. So today I will be talking about access control. And in case you weren't here yesterday, which I think I see all familiar faces, I am George Danezis, and I'm usually associated with University College London, where we teach a whole master's on information security, including on access control. Now, this particular section of secappdev, is kind of backed by quite a few material that you can find, I think, even online. I think Ross Anderson Security Engineering in particular is online and will teach you some things about access control. There is a very classic paper that is quite an oldie. It's from 1981 that describes a lot of the techniques that at the time were considered state of the art. To some extent, my thinking about access control and to some extent a little bit what's important and what's not important in this particular time of the course comes from Ninhui Lee's course in Purdue on access control. He spends about 30 hours talking about it. I only have an hour and a half here. So it's going to be the best of, really, and the highlights. So what is access control? So access control, first of all, is a mechanism. And this is a very important thing to realize. Yesterday, I talked about the difference between policy and mechanism. And I said that the policy is really what a security system is trying to achieve, what bad things it prevents, tries to prevent. The mechanism is actually the means by which it tries to do that, right? And because access control is usually the mechanism and one of the most prominent mechanisms that we ever use to implement any security policies, very often people think, well, you know, my security policy is whatever my access control mechanism says, right? And this is kind of a mistake, okay? Because as we will see in a second, access control mechanisms are actually quite limited in being able to express what you would like to do or what you would like not to happen in terms of your policy. So it's just one particular mechanism to protect your security policy, and there have to be many more to have a secure system. So the fundamental problem that access control systems tries to solve is given a particular action within the system, performed by a particular principle in the system, whether the action should go ahead or not. Conceptually, it's a rather simple question. Something is about to happen in the system. The access control system kicks in and says, should it happen or not? And of course, it should happen only if it is within the security policy. Okay, that's the idea. If we're dealing with, let's say, a Unix access control system, we can ask the question, can Alice access a particular file? Okay, that's an access control decision. If we're in the realm of networking, we can ask whether Bob can open a socket to a particular port or bind to a particular port or send maybe a packet to a particular address. If we're a firewall, okay, that's a security decision, which is an access control decision. And then we can also think about access control in much higher level systems like databases and ask the question, you know, can Charlie write to this particular record, okay, in a database system? So if the answer to those questions is yes, we say that the principles are authorized or have permission to do something. Otherwise, we say that they're unauthorized and the access is denied. And I'm sure you've tried to use many systems where that just happened, even though you believe that it was within the security policy that you should access something, which is a good first indication that policy and access control is not quite the same. So put like this, access control seems like a straightforward problem, and really it is not. And this is where we're going to spend an hour and a half looking at really at the foundations of why it is actually not just a hard problem, but pretty much an impossible problem, and we'll have to live with it. So what can go wrong with it? What can go wrong? The first problem is expressiveness. Because access control systems are security systems, they need to be small, fast, simple, etc. So how can you express extremely complex policies in terms of the access control decisions you have to make? So for example, you can have something really complex, such as access to a particular file is only allowed if George is trying to access the file and Frank happens to be in his office. Okay? That's a perfectly nice policy goal. But of course now, if you try to express that in terms, let's say, of a Unix access control system or a Windows access control system, well, it's just not possible. You would have to build a lot of stuff on top of it to actually be able to even express that policy. Okay? So the access control system limits the kind of policies you can implement. The second problem is efficiency. Okay? It is not cool, since we have to actually check for permissions every time we access a particular object in the system, for that check to take a very long time. Because your system then ends up just doing access control and not any useful work. Okay? So in the example before where, you know, Frank had to be in his office and I had to actually access a file, it is not cool to say, well, that's okay, we'll just send a courier to find out if Frank in his office come back and then tell you if you can access a file or not. Okay? It has to happen instantly. It has to be a tiny little overhead over the actual operation. The third problem is that for access control to actually provide a robust mechanism to implement any security policy, it has to achieve what is called full mediation. And this was one of the principles we saw yesterday. Namely, every single access that may have some security relevance needs to be mediated, checked, and controlled by the access control system. Okay? That creates a huge bottleneck, which kind of relates to the efficiency, but it also causes a lot of mistakes. What if you just forget? What if you just define in your system some function that accesses something sensitive, let's say, but you don't check if, you know, actually the user has permission? And finally, and this is the question on which we will spend quite a bit of time, there is the problem of safety. As we said yesterday, we have policies and mechanisms, and the important thing is to actually make a security argument, to say the mechanism that I have really does implement my policy. And this is what the problem of safety in access control system is. Can we actually really make systematically an argument that an access control system with all its parameters and configurations and particular data that it works on indeed implements a particular set of policy goals? And we will see that this is harder than it seems. Now, this is a real problem. This is not just some academic problem. So I pulled from the top 25 common weakness enumerations database, some of them that are actually relevant to access control and authorization generally. And the ones in pink are within the top 25, so of bugs out there. And indeed, you see missing authorization. This is just someone forgetting to do the access control where it should have been. Execution with unnecessary privileges. This is basically, you know, giving a particular principal executing some stuff more privileges than they need, which may be abused, which is associated with the expressivity sometimes of how we implement access control systems, and we'll see examples of that. And then incorrect permission assignment for critical resource. This is really a sad bug, right? I mean, it's just configuration mistakes and all that stuff. It is not as glorious even or as exciting as the buffer overflows we see yesterday, right? I mean, where at least, you know, it's quite sophisticated to do. It's just someone forgetting some permission or getting it wrong, okay? And what do you do about it? It happens all the time. The ones in bold are related to authentication. And why is it that I also put the ones on bold? It's because we have to really understand where access control fits within the mechanisms that make a secure system. Okay? Usually, our secure system is implemented in the following way. Alice is the principal, and she would like to perform some action, for example, write in some database at the back end. Usually, what we see, and this is something that should be quite apparent from your experience, the first step to do that is to authenticate who the principal is. Okay, so usually if you're on the web, you would ask for some password, or if you are in front of a terminal, it will ask you for some password or some token or anything like that. And then we establish who Alice is beyond doubt. Okay, this is the process of authentication, and the bugs in bold before were basically authentication bugs that gets that wrong. If you get that wrong, forget about authorization. You know, you're basically already violating the security policy in any way. Now, assuming that you know who Alice is, your problems have not ended. Then authorization and the access control problem kicks in, and you have to say, okay, great, I have Alice here, I have a request from Alice to write on a particular record of a database, is she actually allowed or not? Okay? And then these are the bugs in pink that kicked in. It is very important to realize that both authentication and authorization and all the technical underpinnings of them, software, hardware, tokens, whatever, documents in cabinets, are part of the trusted computing base. If any of those fail, your security policy cannot be enforced anymore. Okay? If you're an attacker, this is the sweet spot to attack. It's kind of lame to just try to attack to, you know, get a record in a database. Like, real attackers try to actually attack one of those systems to be able to just do anything they want. So there are two flavors in the literature of access control systems. And really, there is a very deep split, even in the community, starting in the 70s and the 80s, between those who do one thing and those who do another thing. The first type of access control systems are what is called mandatory access control systems. Those are access control systems where there is a policy, as in any secure system, that pretty much restricts what subjects within the system can do. Okay? So that means that, for example, you're an employee in a bank, and you have in front of you some system to, for example, deal with transactions and cash coming in or authorizing transactions. The security policy dictates what you are allowed to do on the objects of the system. Okay? You have no say about that. You are the subject of that policy. And this is why it's mandatory. Okay? It's imposed on you. Now, this has a long history of applications in the US military. In fact, what is called the Orange Book, which defined effectively what a secure system was for the DoD, mandated a mandatory access control system. And the idea there is, of course, that the US military has secrets, as we know. And if you are authorized, for example, to access a secret, that does not mean that you're authorized to just also copy the secret or give it to your friends. Okay? And this is why they went for the mandatory flavor of access control, to prevent you, even if you have access, for example, to read a secret, to then further give it away. And as you can see, these restrictions were somehow relaxed in the last few years, leading to massive, massive exfiltration of data, as we have seen in the last few months. However, mandatory access control policies are also useful in other environments, where effectively whoever holds data or has some rights over data does not have ultimate authority over the data. You can think of hospital systems that need to implement mandatory access control. Banks, of course, you don't want every clerk in the bank that can read or do something specific on an account to be able to just change the balance of the account. Okay? So usually you have mandatory access control policies in this environment. However, in our day-to-day computing experience, we mostly see the second type of access control system, which is the discretionary access control system. Okay? And discretionary access control system really became super popularized with the Unix operating system. And there is the concept of an owner. The idea is that you, as a subject in the access control system, create some resources, like files, usually in the Unix system. And you're the owner of those files. And you can read them and write them and do whatever you want. Okay? And furthermore, you can let other people do whatever they want with the files you own. Okay? And this is called discretionary because you have discretion over your own resources. There is no overarching security policy that actually forces you to do anything like that. However, it is important to realize that discretion has to be applied within a security policy. So the fact that the owner of the file has the right to do things to the file that could violate the policy, or to transfer the file, or to delegate rights to others, okay, means that suddenly the owners of the files have to actually make decisions in accordance with the security policy, otherwise the security policy won't hold. Okay? So suddenly we start putting the principles that make those decisions to delegate or transfer, to read or to write, within our trusted computing base. Now, back in, I guess, the early 70s, there was a lot of confusion about how to implement access control systems. And Butler Lampson, who, amongst other things, has done a lot of systems work, came up with a very, very simple formalization that is so common today that we just take it as granted, which is the formalization of the access control matrix. Okay? And at the heart of most access control systems, we have this access control matrix. What is this matrix? On one side, it contains objects, okay? And usually we put them as columns. And as rows, it contains subjects. Okay? And then within the cells of the matrix, it contains permissions or rights. And the triplets that are defined in this matrix define what is allowed and what is not allowed at a particular time in the system. Now, it's a matrix. Therefore, a picture is easier to actually visualize than just words, right? So here is an example. We have the subjects as rows. We have the objects as columns. In this particular case, it's for a file system, so it's just files. And then we have within the cells a particular set of rights. Okay? So, and then, of course, the access control system should be able to answer questions like this. Can Alice read file 1? Can she? Yes, good. Good. Can Bob write file 1? No. Can Alice write file 3? Can Alice write file 3? No. Good. Straightforward. If anything, I have reinforced your feeling that I'm going to waste an hour of your time, because that's it, right? I mean, what is there to it? What is there to it, right? So, things get interesting when we realize that it is not the case that we have an access control matrix that was given to us at the beginning of time and will stay throughout the life of the universe and die with it. The access control matrix itself has to evolve. Okay? Someone has to set that access control matrix. Now, in the case of mandatory access control systems, one can say, well, that's not really our problem, because the access control matrix is set once and for all by the security designers, engineers, managers, and everybody else just lives with it. It's relatively static. Even in that case, that's not true, because, of course, you have new objects, new subjects, et cetera, et cetera. Someone has to change that access control matrix. However, in discretionary access control systems, it is inherent that the access control matrix changes, because, as we have said, the doctrine of this discretionary system is that the owner can basically do what they like with their particular files or objects, subject to the security policy. So, suddenly, our access control matrix, A, has to change, okay? But of course, we don't want it to change in a way that may violate our security policy, which may be as simple as, you know, the owner has the right to change permissions. So suddenly, not only it has to encode the rights that subjects have on objects, but also the rights that subjects have to change the access control matrix itself. Okay, to make sure that this is also subject to some policy that makes sense. Okay, so the access control matrix has to change according to some rules that basically rely on information in the access control matrix. So what are those rules? So this leads us to the very first, I would say, solid model for how to do discretionary access control, which is the Graham-Denning model. And as you expect, in the Graham-Denning model, you have the access control matrix with subjects and objects, as we had before. And of course, you will recognize read and write as permissions in the access control matrix itself. However, we have some extra things here. First of all, subjects are somehow also objects of the policy. So they also appear as columns. That's the first weird thing, I would say. Secondly, we have some very specific and very special permissions called control and owner, okay? And that denotes, in the case of a subject-subject relationship, that that particular subject does control, in fact, another subject, okay? And this is why we say that Alice indeed controls Alice. Alice is Alice. And Bob controls Bob, okay? And then we have a special relationship between subjects and objects, which is the owner relationship. And here we can see that Alice does own file 1, okay? And actually Bob owns file 3, okay? And of course we can answer the same questions as before about whether Alice can read file 1, file 3, etc. And the answer is exactly the same as before. However, there is also another final little subtlety, which is not illustrated here, that a right may also be transferable or not. And we say that it's transferable if we put a star next to it. Now, given that we have an access control matrix like this, how can it evolve over time? And it evolves according to 8 simple rules or commands, okay? So first of all, a subject can create an object, okay? If that happens, we add a column for that object, and we also say that the subject is the owner of that object. That's the idea of discretionary access control. Of course, a subject can also create a subject, and this is slightly more interesting why you would want to do that. Okay? At this point, we add a row and a column for that new subject, and we also say that the old subject controls the new subject. Okay? So this is about creation of resources and subjects. Of course, we also want to be able to destroy things in the system. So a subject, of course, can destroy an object O, but only if they are the owner. Okay, so there is an access control check here to see if we're allowed to modify the access control matrix itself. Okay, so if the subject is the owner of an object, it can delete that object, and then we just delete the column. If you're also controlling another subject, I think, actually there is a mistake here, you can delete another subject. That should say control, not own. Now, yes?
So what's the difference between owner and controller? Because going back 2 slides, you say...
Control is traditionally subject-subject. Own is subject-object, I believe.
Forward one.
Yes?
You had that...
Yes. Two. Yes, I see what you're saying. So, yeah. That's a good question, actually. I had forgotten about the fact that owner is really about being able to delete. I think that the answer will appear in a couple of slides. I think that I misspoke, actually. I think that it is if you are the owner of another subject that you can delete that subject indeed. And controlling probably has other rights associated with it, but I'll have to remind myself by looking forward a couple of commands to see if indeed it's necessary. Sometimes it's actually quite other subtleties that I'm not actually talking about here that it refers to. But thank you for pointing that out. Okay, so basically, we can create, then we become the owners or controllers, or we can delete if we're the owners. That's the important thing. And then the interesting part about the system's discretionary access control system is that we can grant or transfer rights to others, okay? Because they are a file, so we can let others do things to them. So a subject can grant a right, R or R star, to another subject if, basically, they are the owner of that resource. Okay? It's as simple as that. And then a subject can transfer a right if, so now that's subtle, if they actually already have the right and it is actually a transferable right, and then they can transfer it to someone else, either itself as a transferable right or as a simple right. Okay? So if you give someone a right, you can say that I'm giving you a transferable right, and despite the fact that they're not the owner, they can pass it on to someone else. Okay? And this is what delegation is about. Then we want to do revocation. We want to be able to take away rights. And this is actually quite cute here. So a subject X can really delete a right from an object O that a subject S has. Okay? Either if it controls, and this is where your question is, okay, so if I control the subject, I can delete any right that it has, or if I am the owner of the resource, I can delete subjects from being able to access that resource. Okay? And this is the difference, I think, between control and own. Okay? And there is one final thing, which actually does not change the state of the access control matrix, which is that if you're either the controller of a subject or the owner of an object, you can ask whether a particular permission exists in the access control matrix. That does not actually change its state, but it allows you to find out what's going on, but it also allows you to have some privacy. You cannot query things that are totally unrelated to you, which is very important in a military setting because you don't want people to be able to even find out that objects exist in the system, let alone enumerate them or query or anything like that. I'll pick up my watch to make sure we stay on time. So, as you can see now, it isn't really the case that we just have the access control matrix. What we have is we have an access control matrix that evolves over time, because now our subjects are going to be executing all these commands, creating new things, deleting things, transferring rights to each other happily, okay? And we as security engineers need to work out, well, is everything that could happen within the security policy? Okay, that's the safety problem. So first of all, let's see a little bit why Graham Denning created some of the subtle rules, right? Let's consider the following problem to get a little bit familiar with this policy. So let's say that Alice is the owner of file one. She's created file one, she's happy. However, if you remember yesterday, one of the key principles is the principle of least privilege. We don't want processes to be executed with privileges to do more things than we want them to do, because if they're hacked using one of the tricks that that Frank presented yesterday, then they might run wild through our system and start changing other things, right? So ideally speaking, we want to confine processes to only be able to do the thing that they strictly need to do. How do we implement that? Using a Graham-Denning process. So we start with a state where Alice is the owner of file one. And let's say this is the only permission that exists in the system. Does anyone have any insights about how we would go about making sure that when Alice, as ultimately a principal, well, as a person, executes on file one, she cannot actually do anything else in the system but basically access file one, assuming that she had other rights? Any insights?
I don't think I understood the question.
Okay. So the question is the following. We have Alice. Amongst other things, she owns file one. Alice wants to write, to run a program. Okay? And she wants her program to only be able to modify, or let's say in this particular case, read. Okay? She only wants the program to read file one. Okay? She doesn't want the program to read or write any other files, and she doesn't even want the program to be able to write file one. How can we use what we have seen so far to achieve that? Please.
Create a new subject and delegate access.
Good. Let's see that. So, as we said, Alice starts with an access control matrix up there. She's both the owner and the controller of Alice, which goes back to what you discussed before, and she's the owner of file one. Okay, the problem with just executing a program as it is that the program will execute with the full privileges of Alice. The full privileges of Alice is that she's the owner and the controller of file one. Therefore, the program could set any permissions on file one, including write or delete or anything like that, and do whatever it wants, not just read, which is our goal. So what do we do? First of all, subject Alice creates another subject, Alice 0. Okay? That creates a new line in our access control matrix. That also creates a new column. The new column says that Alice, the old Alice, controls Alice 0 and owns Alice 0. Okay? Then 3, Alice grants a write read on object file 1 to subject Alice 0. So suddenly, we have a read here. She's allowed to do that because she's the owner of file 1. Okay? And now suddenly, Alice can take the persona Alice 0 and run a program that can only read file 1. Furthermore, because the program acts as Alice 0, it has no other privileges to own Alice or to own a particular file, and therefore cannot actually change the permissions to grant itself more rights. Okay? Therefore, it cannot anymore, let's say, okay, I'm Alice, I'm going to start writing that file as well. Is that clear? So we actually achieve a least privileged policy by forking Alice and, you know, having an Alice 0 with fewer privileges. Now, this is a cheat sheet about all the rules. And we have already seen that access control decisions are relatively simple to answer. Can Alice access this? Can Alice access that? But there is a slightly more subtle question, which relates to safety, which is, could Alice read file one? This is Alice. This is file one. What's the answer? Could Alice read file one? Yes?
She could grant herself
read-writes. Exactly. So she would have to grant herself read-writes. If she just tries to read as it is, computer will say no. Okay, you don't have read access. But that's not a problem. She grants herself read-writes. She can do that. She's the owner. And then reads the file. That question is a bit brain dead, right? I mean, yeah, she could do that. She's the owner. Could Bob read file one? Any ideas? Could Bob read file one?
She asked Alice for permission.
Yes. So there is a chain of events that could allow Bob to read file one, which is Alice grants Bob read, and then Bob reads the file. Okay? So there is this issue of safety here, which is that if we say that an access control system is there to really, as a mechanism, implement a security policy, how do we know in general if there is a pattern of granting, requesting, and all that stuff that may allow a principal to do an operation that would violate the security policy? And even that question is quite subtle, okay? Because it is not really clear what it even means, is there a chain of events? Because this chain of events does rely on particular principals making security decisions and providing other people with rights. Or sometimes, and this is actually quite common, it relies on programs executing on behalf of principals, following some complicated rules, granting other people accesses. So the general problem stands, and it's usually much more complex than this simple example, namely, I have a discretionary access control system. I have some complicated rules that are programmatic about, you know, if this happens, that access is granted, and if this other thing happens, that other access is granted. And then I have to say, okay, great. Given an initial state of an access control matrix, can I actually make a statement that is as simple as no one except the administrator will ever be able to override the log files? It's a very simple statement of policy, but given that I have an access control matrix and complicated rules that modify it, can I actually say, yes, I am sure it cannot happen? Okay, that's the problem of safety. So the problem of safety was identified very early on, and actually Mr. Harrison, Russo, and Ullman, three different people, did try to provide, I think, they started off trying to provide a positive answer. They said, okay, great, there is this big problem here, right? The problem of safety. We want to make a security argument that takes the mechanism and say, yes, it implements a simple security policy like the log file cannot be overridden. Let's just have a generic framework to be able to prove such things, okay? So what did they do? Classic paper, by the way, you can read it. It contains a few things that are quite oldish now, and the people working on this topic have a lot of follow-up work on this. So it's not gospel, but it's still worthwhile to read to understand the frame of mind. So they said the following thing, right? I mean, they set out to prove effectively that you can have a security argument, and then they basically said, okay, what we're going to do is a meta description of what an access control system with delegation does, okay? And they said, in our system, we are going to also have, you know, some objects, some subjects, and an access control matrix as the state of an access control system. But then we're going to define in a generic way the rules that allow us to modify the access control matrix in a way that we can describe things like Gray and Denning, but also other things, okay? So they have a pattern for what the rules that modify the access control system look like. Okay? And what is the general shape of these rules? It should be quite familiar to you. They say a command that changes the access control system state has some preconditions on usually the access control matrix. So it has an if condition, and then a bunch of operations on the access control matrix. So here is one example that is quite close to what Gray and Denning was doing. If you want to grant a read-write between subject X1, X2, and the object Y, you say, if X1 owns Y, then you enter in the matrix that subject X2 can read Y. Okay? So here is a particular example of a command that follows that pattern. So Mr. HRU said all our commands will just follow that pattern. Okay? And what can appear here is just general predicates, things that are true or false on the access control matrix usually. What can appear here is a set of commands. Okay? And what are those commands? They are whatever you expect to be able to do to change the access control matrix. You can place triplets in the access control matrix. You can delete them. You can create subjects, create objects, delete subjects, and delete objects. Okay? So anything that allows you to modify a matrix. Okay? Reading the matrix is not actually in their model. I think they assume that everybody can read the matrix because they were concerned with safety, not privacy, of the matrix. Yeah. So as an exercise at home, just to familiarize yourself with this, you can try to express all the rules that we've seen in Graham Denning, the 8 rules, except for the privacy one, as just commands in that, commands, let's say, in that framework, right? Things that have a precondition and a bunch of commands. Okay? Good. And then they say, okay, great. You know, if we have any access control matrix to start with, and we have any set of commands that follow that pattern, precondition, actions, preconditions, actions, preconditions, actions, can we actually say that a particular property will hold on the system no matter what happens? Okay? So Ninkri says, suppose a subject S plans to give subject S prime a particular right. Okay? Is it possible to say that this right is never going to be assigned, for example, to another subject? That's one example of a property we would like to prove. So if I assign another administrator right, can I really guarantee that someone else will never get right on the logs? Example property. Now, the idea here is that, of course, everything that could happen may happen. Okay, so to some extent, we have the access control matrix, and the commands effectively take the access control matrix from one state to the next state. But of course, we don't want to say that anything that could happen will happen. We more want to say there may be some principles in the system on which I do not want to rely upon to enforce my security policy. I do not want to put them in the trusted computing base. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to remove from my access control matrix all the people that I actually trust. Okay? Maybe the administrators, the people who I believe will make sound security decisions. And that will leave a residual matrix full of rights and subjects that can move things around. And then I want to say, is there a particular transition from that matrix to a matrix where my property is violated? Okay? So for example, where the log can actually be written. Okay? So we remove the reliable subject from the matrix. Otherwise, it makes no sense. If I am in the matrix and I own the file and I could transfer it in a moment of folly to my adversary, of course, it would never be safe. So this is what they managed to prove. Remember, I think that, I mean, this is my conjecture, but I think they started off hoping that they would be able to actually prove that. Instead, they proved pretty much an impossibility result. They said that in the general case, it is impossible, it is not computable, to actually answer the question, is a particular property going to hold? For general properties, general matrices, access control matrices, and general sets of commands. Okay? And actually, the way they argue about this is quite elegant and quite cute. They said, given the expressivity of the commands, this if actions, okay, and given the access control matrix that can basically contain any number of rows, columns, and actions in there, what we can do is we can define a Turing machine. Okay? And if we actually run forward in this and do transitions, this is effectively a probabilistic Turing machine that can compute anything, that can compute any functions. Therefore, they say the Rice's theorem applies that says that it is impossible to define basically, well, to take a program and state any non-trivial properties of that program in general. And since actually now it is a Turing machine, this access control system running forward, and in fact it is executing a program when it applies the commands, it is impossible to actually say that it has, at the end, when it finishes, any particular properties, except for trivial properties that hold for all programs. That's a bit disappointing, isn't it? Because it means that in general you cannot have a safety property and you cannot actually have a security argument, which kind of sucks, really. So, can we water a bit our game here? Can we just maybe do something simpler? What if we remove the ability to destroy or delete things? It's still undecidable. It turns out that you can still just grow your matrix and just ignore the previous entries and still encode a Turing machine, and you still cannot prove safety. What if we cannot create subjects and objects? Then it turns out the problem is tractable, because what you can do is you can enumerate all the states, even though it might take you a very, very long time indeed, and just check each of these states for whether the property holds or not, and say yes if it holds for everything. So despite the fact that in theory it could be possible, it's computable, from a complexity perspective, point of view, it would be improbable that you would ever finish that calculation, even though it would finish eventually if you had infinite time. And then finally, they proved a positive result. And this is really sad as a positive result, because they say, if we restrict the kind of commands that we allow users to define to actually only contain a single action, okay, then we can show that our system will have or will not have a certain non-trivial property. But if you think about it, this is the most useless access control system ever. Because, for example, let's take the simplest command that basically allows someone to create a resource. The create resource has no precondition. Anyone can create a resource. But it has two actions. You have to create, first of all, a line in the matrix for a new subject, you have to create a column for a new object, and then you have to enter, okay, in the intersection of that new object and the old subject, the fact that they are at least the owner. Okay, so that's two actions. If you're not allowed to do more than one action, you cannot even express that. Okay, so despite the fact that you could show it's safe, it's basically safe because it's not very powerful. You cannot actually do a lot of things that you would want to do to protect your system in this case. So what are the lessons here? The lessons here is when our access control matrix is a static object, life is relatively simple and quite straightforward. Okay? Sadly, this is never the case. Okay? Our access control matrix has to change. And I mean, there are two ways of going about this. Either it changes and then no one knows what's happening in the system and you just hope that people don't make mistakes and change it against the policy, okay? Or you try to build a security argument and you say, well, it's okay, I understand how it changes and I know it won't violate my security policy. Sadly, in the general case, this is impossible to do, okay? However, we should not despair. The HRU argument says that it's impossible for any program, for any set of commands and for any access control matrix. It does not mean that there may be non-complete ways of taking a specific set of commands and a specific access control matrix and in specific cases saying, yes, a property holds. What it means, though, is that sometimes that program would say, I do not know. Maybe it is safe, maybe it is not unsafe, I just do not know. So it means that we cannot actually have a checker that is complete. And since the 70s, I think that the computer science community has learned to live with these things. The fact that, for example, there are useful tools that allow you to check for termination, despite the fact that we know that whether a program terminates or not is not something decidable. I think there can be very useful tools that analyze access control matrices and systems, despite the fact that in some cases they may say, sorry, I just don't know. Okay? So don't despair because of this. However, keep in mind very clearly that it is not a trivial problem. Okay? And if you make tools and use tools that check for these resources, they may well just come back and say, sorry, I can't help you. So this was a little bit of theory just to show you the depth of this seemingly trivial field. And it's theory that comes from a very long time ago. However, there are very practical issues as well about access control. And now we're really going into how do you go about implementing, let's say, access control matrices into real systems. Clearly, you don't just want to have a big matrix somewhere. So one note, first of all, is that access control is pretty much domain specific. If you think about subjects, objects, and rights, they really form little sentences. And I did this already. I said, Alice can read file one. Okay. The problem is that both the subjects, the objects, and the rights live within a particular realm, right? So if you talk about a file system, it knows about users maybe of an operating system, about files, and about reading and writing those files. It doesn't know probably anything about networks or databases, right? If basically you deal with databases, they would know about records, they would know about subjects of the database, they would know about reading, appending, adding to tables, they would know about tables, whereas the operating system doesn't know anything about database tables. Similarly, if you are looking at a network, you know, it knows about IP addresses. For example, a firewall will have to make access control decisions usually on the basis of IP address. It doesn't automatically know who's logged in the system and controls a particular socket that basically sends a message from a particular port and IP address. Okay? So it is necessary, and we see that everywhere, to replicate access control within pretty much every subsystem. Just because different subsystems don't even know about the internals of other subsystems to be able to express what the policy should be. And we end up with this kind of Tower of Babel when we try to actually use access control systems to enforce a security policy, namely that, you know, whenever it comes to the networking, we have to configure firewalls in one realm using IPs and all that stuff. Whenever when it comes to files, we have to use access control lists in the Unix security system. And of course, there is nothing that tells us that these things link up to all support the security policy. Okay, so that's one key difficulty there. So you need to re-implement access control in every level, and this is its tragedy. And you will get it wrong, and it's horrible. The second problem is efficiency. And it really links with how do we even store, let alone look up, the access control matrix in the system. Okay? As I said, the trivial solution to that is to just store one big matrix somewhere. Okay? And then, you know, just read it and write it. This is not a very good idea, okay? Because you want somehow the access decisions to be quite local to whatever operation is happening, okay? So there are really two ways that have been devised in the literature for storing this access control matrix, and they can be broadly thought out as per row or per column, okay? So when we choose to store the access control matrix per column, this mechanism is called an access control list. Okay? And basically what happens is we take a chunk, a slice, a column of that matrix, and we usually store that slice quite close to whatever object is going to be accessed. Okay? So for example, in Unix file systems, traditionally this quasi-access control matrix, in the case of Unix, is stored next to the metadata of every file, okay, along with its name and its size and a bunch of other things. You actually have a kind of column representation of who has the right to do particular things to that file. Okay? And these are spread across the whole system. So this is good, of course, because it can be stored close to the resource. So whenever we look up the name of the file about to open it, we also can check locally for authorization. It is also good if we want to revoke access to a particular file, okay? Because you can just go to the metadata of the file, flip a bit off, and suddenly, let's say the world cannot access your file anymore. It is, of course, bad if you want to answer questions such as, what permissions does George have in the system? Okay? Because it means that now you have to go throughout the whole system, object per object per object, where your ACLs are stored, and check for each of them, does George have permission to do this, that, or the other, and make a list of the rights. There isn't such a list anywhere else. Alternatively, we can store that matrix per row. And one way of seeing this is by calling it a capability. Okay? We will look a little bit more at capabilities and how they're slightly more complex than just storing the access control matrix per row. So the good thing here is that we can store along with the user all the rights that they may have. Which means that, for example, every time a user logs in, you can also log into the process maybe a set of rights that user has. Okay, and then they are again local to do access control decisions when the process is running. It is good, of course, because we can audit all the rights that a particular user has. But now if we want to answer the converse question to before, namely, who has access to file one, this is a hard question. Because we have to now go through all our user accounts, maybe that are distributed in a big distributed system, and find out, does Alice, Bob, Charlie have access to file one? Okay? So, ups and roundabouts, really. It's difficult, you know, to say there is one better one than the other. However, capability systems have also taken a beating over 40 years now because there is a problem that is associated with revocation. If you implement them in a super naive way, there isn't really a very quick and straightforward way to say, I want Alice not to be able to write to that file again. Because, of course, that decision is not stored close to the file. It's stored along with Alice, okay, per Alice, not per file. Okay, which means that revocation is slow, and in some implementations of distributed capability system, it was actually even impossible. Okay, however, modern systems provide some facilities for doing that, and we'll look at one example. Now, the implementation of access control systems, be it by row or by column, okay, really relies on a very key concept called the reference monitor. The reference monitor is a piece of software, usually in the operating system, if we are dealing with an operating system, access control system, that really has to have three properties. The first one is complete mediation. All accesses to secured, well, to controlled resources have to go through the access control monitor to be checked. Secondly, it's an integrity property. It has to be tamper-proof. Okay? The adversary must not be able to influence it. If your threat model says the adversary has the capability to actually modify your reference monitor, the game is over. Conversely, if you're an adversary, that's your target. Don't aim towards, you know, changing some permission here or there. That's just lame. Okay? If you're into the business, okay, you need to attack the actual reference monitor, because after that, you can do anything you want. You don't have to worry about, oh, I have access to that file, but not this file. You know, you're in business, okay? So the reference monitor is part of the trusted computing base. If the adversary can modify, the game is over, okay? And third, it has to be small, okay? And why does it have to be small? It has to be small because it has to be verified, okay? Either formally or through code review or whatever, in all cases, it is easier to do all of these things if it is small. Yes?
So there's a trade-off there. So you're saying you'd rather have the reference monitor be simple, but the rule set be complicated.
Right.
What's the trade-off of that choice? It's not just black and white, right?
No, it's not. It's not. So it's actually quite an interesting question to what extent the definition of the rules are within the reference monitor. And you know, this is akin to the argument, should the UI be in the kernel, right? So one way of seeing the reference monitor is to say it is the very simple object that basically allows you to take the triplets of, you know, Alice wants to read file one and say yes or no, okay? The mechanics of how you're allowed to change that access control matrix contain some decisions that have to be mediated through the reference monitor, but are not actually part of the reference monitor per se, if you see what I mean. So of course, there will be some function somewhere else that says, you know, change the matrix in that way or the other way, and that will have to change the matrix in particular ways, and then there will be calls to the reference monitor to say, are these changes within the policy, but it is not automatically within the reference monitor per se. However, you're right. The traditional systems, including Windows, Linux, and most web platforms, really kind of don't really make a distinction between all that. You just have a monolithic thing that both does authorization at a very tactical level and also allows you to do much more high-level complex things in exactly the same way as you would have a UI in the kernel because, oh well, you know, why not? It's gotta run fast, it's gotta be somewhere, you know, why not there, right? Yeah. Does that answer your question?
Can I continue with
yeah, yeah.
This?
Yeah, I understand. So, I mean, my answer to that is really colored by my personal history of having worked in Microsoft Research in Cambridge. And one of the lines of work there was on what was called policy languages, which effectively are languages to express access control mechanisms and access control rules, but quite complex rules that are in the form that we saw before. If that is the case, then you can basically do that and you can say this, and you know, if that person says this, then you know that is allowed, etc., right? So my advice is always to actually try to express the rules separately from the core that actually just interprets those rules that has to have a very high integrity. The rules themselves also have to have a high integrity, but they belong in a different realm because there are some engineering problems, right? What happens when you want to change the rules? Do you actually want to be going back and changing your reference monitor all the time? Does that mean that you have to review it, re-verify it, et cetera? It's ugly, right? So both of them are actually in the TCB, no matter how you see it, because if you can tamper with the rules, then you know that also is a problem. But I think they are verified and even defined by very different people very often and modified at different rates as well. I think that in the web realm and also in other realms, the tragedy is that if you're a web developer, you have to actually rewrite that engine on your own. So suddenly you want to do a kind of mundane web app sometimes. It has to be secure. The last thing you want is to just go and re-implement one of these very complex policy languages, right? And I think it is a failure of our community that we have not packaged up already made very high quality components to do all that, right? Right,
don't even
right.
Horizontal access control. This is pretty much every frame.
I agree.
Screwed in the web world.
Yeah, yeah. It's so bad that I didn't want to put it on the slide because it's depressing. So, the concept of the reference monitor, in fact, and again, this is like a historical aside, was first mentioned in this Air Force report in 1973. And in the same report, they actually mentioned the first buffer overflow. So that's the first buffer overflow mentioned. So there is another key concept that you can choose to use when implementing access control system or not, which is the concept of ambient authority. Okay? Now, to make an access control decision, a triplet must be made available to the reference monitor that says, I am Alice, I want to read file one. Okay? But of course, if you write a program and you execute it as Alice, it's a bit tedious to keep saying, by the way, I'm Alice, and I would like to write file one. And by the way, I am still Alice, and I want to do file two. And you know, I'm still Alice, and I want to do file three. It's, you know, it's tedious and inefficient. Okay? So many access control systems, particularly, I think pretty much all of the ones that are based on access control lists, just define always an ambient principle to be performing all actions. So when you start a process in Unix, for example, it assumes the ID of whoever started it. Okay, so my processes run as user George. And then anything that my processes do, for example, my process will do open file one for read and write. You see, this open does not say, oh, by the way, it's George that opens, okay? Because it is assumed that this open acts with the privileges of the effective user ID. And this is why we say there is this ambient authority, because it is implicit. It is not quite there. The subject is missing. But it is inferred because, of course, the operating system will get that call from a process that has a particular user ID associated with it. That sounds nice, right? Because it's more usable to do that than to have to keep rewriting who's doing it. Somehow, it actually has some downsides, though. The first downside is that it makes it easy to write programs that always perform actions with all the privileges they have. Okay, I just say open, but of course, if someone takes over my program, they can also do everything else because my authority is kind of ambient and it's everything that I can do. Okay, so that's the first problem. It kind of encourages a poor practice, which is very difficult to undo once it's entrenched. The second problem is actually more serious, and is the problem of the confused deputy. And this is what the confused deputy attack or problem is about. So imagine we have a process for Alice. It runs with Alice's privileges. That's cool. And we have a process for Bob. It runs with Bob's privileges. That's cool. And we have some database that Bob can read. Alice cannot read that database. It has only that particular entry in its access control matrix. But then somehow, Alice manages to convince Bob, okay? For example, Alice sends a message to Bob and says, hey, Bob, what was that record in the database that we talked about the other day? Okay? And Bob is like, oh, I'd like to be helpful. Right? I'd like to be helpful. Let me go and read the database. That access passes. Bob is allowed to read the database. And then Bob says, oh yeah, here is the record that we talked about last week. Okay? And so suddenly, Alice has gained access to a record in a database that she did not have the right to access. Now, first of all, the way I described it probably sounds like, I mean, is Bob stupid? Like, why would he do that, right? I mean, we are in a security system. Everybody is assumed to be, like, potentially an adversary. We're all paranoid. Why would Bob do that? But in fact, this is exactly what happens every time you access, let's say, a web server, right? You are sitting in your terminal, you're like, oh yeah, you know, click on that link. The web server basically accesses with the privileges of the web server, the databases and all that stuff, and sends you back things. Okay, and somehow this is normal, right? I mean, we have come to believe that this is the way the world it is, and how do we avoid the confused deputy problem, right? This is actually exactly the same example with that is found within the documentation of the CherryPy Python framework. It has a documentation about how to do file downloads, and it contains a confused deputy problem, where you can just basically read any file on the hard disk with the privileges that this executes. Why is that? How do we usually say to our users we avoid this problem? Oops, sorry. How to avoid confused deputy problems? I got the slides wrong. First of all, one solution is to re-implement access control in Bob's process, okay? And this is how we deal with it in the web, right? I mean, we get a client request. We don't just go and read the database and return a record. We actually say, wait a second, who are you? Okay, who are you, Alice? Do you actually have the right to access a particular file? So there is a replication, as we said before, of the access control system at a higher level. Okay. Another solution is for Bob to be able to use the access control system to ask the question, okay, I am about to access a particular resource on behalf of Alice. Okay? Am I allowed to do this? And this is a very different scenario than replicating the access control system. We're still using the same access control system, but now Bob has the ability to say, I am about to do an access, but this access is not with my authority, but with Alice's authority. If it says access denied, then I will just say to Alice, sorry, it seems that you're not allowed to actually access that resource. Okay? But of course, ambient authority is exactly the mechanism that prevents you to do that. When you say open to a file, you don't say I'm opening on behalf of myself or on behalf of someone else. You just say open, and it always happens on behalf of yourself. So you cannot actually express the key thing that would allow you to solve the confused deputy problem, namely that you are about to execute an action on behalf of someone else. Okay? The third way of avoiding the confused deputy problem is to use a capability-based architecture, which we will discuss in a second. So we talked about access control lists and how they store objects. They store the access control matrix per object. We also said that they pretty much all, I think it is fair to say that I have never seen an access control system that doesn't, provide this concept of ambient authority, okay? Where accesses happen under one authority of the subject, but you cannot really express that you're doing accesses on behalf of someone else, and therefore making it very difficult to express either least privilege policies or to express that you're about to do an action that actually only should succeed if someone else has permission, not if you have permission. So the alternative, as we said, is to conceptually store the matrix per subject. Okay, and these were traditionally called capability architectures. However, capability architectures themselves have really evolved over the years to be much more than just storing the access control matrix per row. So there is a very interesting paper called Capability Myths Demolished. And this is not so much a research paper as much as a polemic. Okay? And it's a polemic that really captures the soul of the access control community, if you want. And if you read it, you will see the true bitterness and human tragedy that has really kind of, you know, divided that community between the people who believe that we learned in the 1960s that capability systems are impossible because of revocation, for example. Okay, and we've known that. It's like a scientific truth. Okay, and why are people keep banging on about them on one side? And on the other side, the authors of this paper who believe that capability system is the only way that will guarantee us to get out of the rut in terms of the whole computer security problem we have and actually secure our systems. Okay? So there is this amazing tension between those two communities, okay, that is really in this paper. And this paper basically takes a very petty and personal approach to saying, you know, quote, you know, some capability system problem, and then just basically saying this is rubbish, pretty much in those terms. Not quite rubbish, but pretty much, you know, you can read between the lines that they did want to use swear words, but they kind of edited them out. What is even more funny is that this paper was submitted for peer review at Usenix 2003. It was rejected, and the authors have posted on a mailing list the reviews of that paper and the reviews that rejected it. And the reviews themselves, I have to say, are as petty and as personal and as biased, if you want, as the paper itself. It is actually quite an embarrassment for the scientific community and a beautiful thing to actually see documented. So, however, I really like this paper because it actually does create a nice, useful taxonomy of capability systems and what they all do, as well as how could you deal with the problem of revocation that is the key problem that people say, you know, if you have a capability system, you can't solve. So, as I said, there are two controversies with capabilities. The first one is revocation. Can I actually quickly turn off a right from someone? And the second problem is uncontrolled delegation. Namely, if I give you a right, well, you know, how do I know that it's not going to go everywhere and I will have absolutely no control over it, including no control over revoking someone else's right to whatever you have delegated them? Okay, so the two play hand in hand as problems. Okay, first, I have difficulty revoking, let alone when I can actually very easily give rights to others that will just go around the system and then I will not be able to revoke them down the line. And also, how can I restrict delegation? How can I play the game that in Graham Denning was this kind of R versus R star right, where if I don't give you a transferable right, you cannot transfer it any further? That is not actually something that can work in a pure capability system. So the authors of this paper define basically the ultimate capability system as being the object capability model. And the object capability model is quite interesting because, you know, it's the kind of extreme form of capability model. However, once I describe it to you, you will be confused and then I'll tell you what it is like and then you will realize it's actually quite familiar to us today. So first of all, the model says objects, and in this particular world, both subjects and objects are all objects. They are just objects, okay? Principles, resources, everything is an object. They can only interact with each other by sending messages on references that they have on each other, okay? So you do not even know how to address something unless you actually have a reference to it. There is no such thing as file one. Either you have a reference to file one or you don't. You cannot just look up file one in the purest form. You might have a service that allows you to look up file one. Okay. Secondly, these references are unforgeable. They're effectively disked out by the trusted computing base. You cannot just try out to guess a reference to, let's say, file one. Okay. So, since they are unforgeable, okay, really they can only be obtained using controlled means. And these controlled means are really threefold, or yes, fourfold. I mean, the trivial one is that you initialize a process, you have a reference to that process or yourself. Parenthood means that if you have initialized a process, you can give it some references, okay? Endowment. No. References to created objects unknown to object subject creator. Okay. So I'm actually a bit confused about the first one. Okay. So, but in any case, so the endowment is basically that you can give references to your children. If you create an object, you can actually give references to other objects. Okay, and this is not dissimilar to what we saw earlier with Alice and Alice Zero. Alice creates Alice Zero and then gives a write reference to the file that Alice Zero can write. Okay, and the introduction is that if Alice has a reference to Bob and a reference to Charlie, Alice can send Bob a message, okay, with a reference to Charlie. So, I am Alice. There is an object subject here that I know and I have a reference to. This is my reference to it. And another one that I know here, and this is my reference to it. What I can do is I can basically say, hey, here's a reference to my other object. Okay. Now, this all sounds very weird if we're like objects everywhere, references everywhere. But in fact, this is, if you think about it, the security model that is implemented by the type safety of the Java language. Okay? In Java, you can only reference objects if you have been given a handle to them, effectively. But of course, there are ways of getting references to the objects through some environment as well. You can, for example, open a file and it will give you a reference to that file. But if you remove all these facilities that allow you to just look up objects and get references to them, and you only use the pure subset of the Java language without those facilities, really, you can only perform an operation on an object if you have actually the instance of that object in your hand. Otherwise, you cannot just guess its pointer and start pointing to it, so it is actually unforgeable within that context, and you can only send messages across effectively those links. Let's have a picture. Okay, that will kind of make things a little bit more concrete. So imagine we have Alice, and Alice has a reference to file one, and Alice has a reference to the printer. Okay? Now, the printer in itself at this point cannot print anything because it doesn't have a reference to anything. Okay? And that's it. The printer cannot do anything in this particular model because it actually has access and permissions to nothing, just possibly the physical printer. So what does Alice do in order for file one to be printed? Okay? She basically has to send a message to the printer on its interface that presumably contains a print command. And then within that message, it actually also provides a reference to file one. Okay? So through that process, the printer gets a reference to file one and now has access to file one, can basically do whatever the interface of that reference to file one allows it to do, usually read or even write possibly, I don't know, and then print the file one. So you may notice here that there is no ambient authority. And this is really important, right? It is not the case that because all of this is actually executed by Alice's process, that somehow Alice, when she says print something, the printer suddenly has access to all her files or anything like that, or even that the program that runs the printer or that does anything else has access to all the references she has access to. She has to explicitly, in that message that says print, give actually a reference to the object, and that only gives to the printer the right to access that particular object. She may have 1,000 other objects, the printer cannot access those. Okay? So by design, you implement, and this is the argument, I guess, in the polemic, by design you implement a least authority policy, because you just give one file, and by design you cannot have a confused deputy, because you execute commands on specific objects that you already had authority to actually access. Okay. Now, the authors go through many, many properties of access control lists and particular different variants of capability models. I do not want to draw you into that controversy in itself. They also say that the object capability system is the best thing after sliced bread. It's cute to read their polemic. You can look at the slides later on. Finally, and this is really the crux of the polemic, okay? They say, and we can do revocation fine, thank you very much, in capability system. You know, all this bad reputation about not being able to do revocation, it's just lies. This is how we do revocation, okay? And let me walk through the revocation mechanism in an object capability system with you, and then I will ask you a very, very important question. Okay? So here it is. So Alice has a reference to Carol, which is just some resource, for example, and has a reference to Bob, which is some principle, let's say. Bob is Bob. So ultimately, what she wants to do is for Bob to be able to do some operation on Carol. Let's say Carol holds some database and, you know, Bob will need to send a message to the database to say write, for example. But we want to do this with the ability for Alice at some moment in the future to revoke that access. Alice wants to be sure that whenever she decides that Bob should not be able to access Carol's functions anymore, she should be able to just say, okay, this is it, I revoke that access. So what does she do? She basically creates two intermediate objects. Object F, which stands for the forwarder, and object R, which stands for the revoker. Okay? And then she basically creates a reference to from F to R and from R to C. She can do that because she has created F and R, she basically just gives them the references to the other objects. So that is totally cool as far as the object capability ideas are concerned. And then what does she do after that? She gives in a message, because you can only transfer on messages on arcs, she gives to Bob, through a message foo, a reference to the forwarder. Okay? Good. So now Bob, whenever he wants to act and send a message on Carol, has to do the following. He sends a message to F. F is just a forwarder that follows exactly the same interface as Carol, so the forwarder just encapsulates that message and forwards it to the revoker. The revoker is just a dumb piece of functionality that just forwards messages, okay, and allows you to also say revoke to drop all the references. So he forwards it to Carol, and Carol says, oh, I got a message. If I got a message, it means that someone was authorized to send me a message just by virtue of having a reference to me. No need to do any other access. I execute it. Okay? So far, so good?
Why is there a need for both forwarders?
But that's my question. That is my question. Why is there a need for two? So,
you could do it one if you could somehow.
That's a very good point. You are very close to it. You're very close to the reason. Let's role play. Let's role play what happens on the revocation. Because so far I described what happens when Bob tries to access Carol, which is straightforward, a message is passed to Carol. On revocation now, Alice sends a message to the revoker that says, drop your reference. And the revoker listens to that message and then basically deletes that arc here. So that arc is dropped. Therefore, next time Bob sends a message through that path, there is no more a reference to Carol, and the request stops there. You cannot forge that reference again. You cannot remember that reference again. It's all over. So that's what happens during revocation. So now, to reiterate your question, why have two layers of a forwarder and a revoker? Why not just have one intermediate object, let's say the revoker or the forwarder?
Because Bob has access to F, so Bob could already intervene with F before Alice revokes it. But Bob cannot intervene with R, with the revoker. He does not have immediate access to the revoker.
Yes, and what does that mean? Yes, indeed. Now, that's a very good point. And that's very close. That's very close, but it's even more subtle than that. So what you're saying is exactly right and is the key to that answer. Namely, the forwarder has exactly the same interface as Carol. The revoker has really two functions that can happen on it, which is forward a message, which happens through F, okay, and revoke, which makes it drop all its, rights. Okay, so you're right to say that if Bob had access to the revoker, then Bob could just drop the references, okay? But why not? Because Bob is already allowed to drop his reference to F, which basically is equivalent to dropping the reference to R. So why not? Right? I mean, so what if, Bob can do that? I agree with you that it's maybe less elegant from an engineering point of view. You know, the interface is not exactly the same. But from a security point of view, why not? Right? So let's imagine what would happen, though, if now Alice wanted to delegate to Carol, the Carol resource, to many different people. Okay? What would she have to do if each of them had the ability to revoke access? Okay? In this particular design, if you want to delegate access to a resource to, let's say, all of you, I would like to delegate to all of you access to my resource. Okay? So what do? I define an R, I define an F, and I give you all access to the same F. Now, if I had a system where there was only one intermediate step, each of you would be able to revoke access, and revoke access not just from yourself, as when you drop your own arc to F, but actually revoke access from everybody else as well. Because the shared reference from R to Carol would have been dropped. Is that clear?
So it's a matter of interfaces, and F is actually a restricted view on R.
F is a restricted view on R.
Where
you cannot revoke, indeed. Therefore, everybody here can share the same F, and therefore, per resource, I only have one chain like that that allows me to revoke access from everybody in the world if I am Alice, but does not allow everybody else in the world to revoke access from everybody else in the world. But that still sounds a bit fishy, because the alternative is the following. I don't do this complex two-step chain. Instead, what I do is the following. I have a one-hop chain, where indeed I have just a forwarder and a revoker compressed that allows you to revoke whatever access you have. And I give a different one to each person. So now I have Carol. I have the object that interfaces between the delegate and Carol. And I have a different object per particular person that I delegate with. What's the problem with that?
You need to revoke each and everyone if you need to cut all the access to Carol.
So you need to revoke each and all of one. So that's a substantive security issue that I would have to go and revoke all of them. But on the other side, one can see it also as a feature. Because maybe I want to revoke you, but not someone else. So that's actually more flexible, right? You are very right. So indeed, you can actually have many different forwarders. And it provides this new nice property, right, that I can revoke one person but not another person, which kind of is very granular. And you would think that this is a huge power of this capability system. However, and this is now a sociological question. However, in their polemic, the authors that are so fond of the capability system choose never to mention that. Why? They choose to never mention what you just said, which is really cool. Hey, you know, I'll just have many forwarders, one per person, or what I just said before. Look, just make one forwarder, one per person. Whoa, it's gone crazy. I don't know why. One per person. Why not? Why did the authors choose to never mention this? Sociology question based on a deep, deep understanding of computer security. Any insights? It's a question for you, Frank, as well. I see you're thinking. Okay, so we have 2 minutes, and I'll let it go. So remember, the main point of the authors was to argue that capability systems are better than access control lists. Okay, they're better on everything. They're fanatics. What is an access control system? It's a system that stores the access control matrix per object, which that means that for each object, there is actually a list of principles with the privileges that they have. So, however, if they implement what you just mentioned or what I mentioned, namely one object, different one for each person, what do we have? We have an object to be protected, Carol, and then we have a list of things, one per principle, that is allowed to do something to that object. And what is that? This is an access control list. And the argument that the authors were making is that access control lists are no good. Okay? And therefore, they could not present that system in that paper. Okay? So, this is just to illustrate to you that not only computer security is full of interesting technical details, but it's also full of intrigue that really, really colors what people basically are even presenting in their papers, no matter how cool it is. But anyway, this is what they propose to do instead. So, just to conclude, access control. My first slide said, well, it should be really boring, right? I mean, here is a triplet, yes, no, what is there to it? Somehow, I hope that over the last hour and a half, I've taken you for a ride through problems of delegation, revocation, access control matrices that change over time, impossibility theorems and incompleteness theorems about proving safety properties of these access control matrices. And then, even, you know, when it comes to implementing these things, which one would think is a very simple engineering approach, right? I mean, we should know what is the better way of doing it. We had 40 years, after all, of experimenting with these things. By the way, the first capability system, the CAP, was actually a machine in the computer laboratory in Cambridge, built in 67, I think, or something like that. It's one of the oldest kind of post, you know, 50s computer. So you would think, well, this is just an engineering detail. We must know how to do it. However, I hope that you are convinced now that even when it comes to should we store the matrix like this, like that, what should be the way we actually express our access control system, there are deep controversies that are both technical and sociological. So please remember, access control is a mechanism, not the policy. Usually you will need many of those to implement a particular policy. And please remember that the more expressive it is and the more complex it is, the least likely you will be able to convince yourself, let alone others, that indeed that particular mechanism in the particular configuration does in fact guarantee some high-level policy goals. Thank you. If you have any questions, I'm available now and in the break. Yes. Sorry.
Spread out in the code of all the objects, even in the pattern you showed, the fact that revoke, unrevoke, drop something is code in the system.
Yes.
So there's no separate kind of set of rules.
Yeah.
So what is your take on that? Do you agree with that?
I agree. That's a bad thing. I think that's a bad thing. However, when I say it's a bad thing, I think that we should be comparative across the options we have. If you implement, let's say, a system using access control lists, and let's take the Unix access control list systems, if you want to do something that is not quite standard, you will still have to encode your logic for whether it is allowed or not in code, namely through an SUID program. So I wouldn't say that this is a downside of the capability systems per se. I would say that it is, again, a failing of our community to actually provide a clear and expressive enough separate high quality, both theory and engineered component that allows us to say, okay, this is the component in which we actually encode the logic of all the moving parts of our access control system, and it lives outside the code that has the moving parts of the actual application domain. That's a huge failure of our community, and I think that the failure comes from the fact that in the 1970s and 80s, the kind of people who were attracted to that problem were more on the theory of computer science because of the beautiful incompleteness results and the potential also to formally verify and all that stuff. And they never really were that, I think, concerned about, you know, what is the engineering detail. I think that to some extent in the last 10 years, we have some systems that allow to do a bunch of these abstractions. So I'm familiar with SecPal, DECAL is another one from Microsoft Research, and a bunch of other systems that allow you to provide a language to express those rules. But again, I don't see any adoption, so I can't really say, okay, we solved that problem and we're all done now. But I don't think it's just a weakness of capability system. However, I agree with you that, you know, they never mention it, but that's because they are, you know, they wouldn't mention anything bad about the system, would they? I mean, they leave that to everybody else who's very keen to please when it comes to bad things, yeah. Any other questions? Okay, I'm available throughout lunch as well. Thank you.